B550 is finally out here in the wild, and I gotta say straight up, this is a weird one of sorts. And for a few reasons, and we'll go over all those before we get into this board right here. But first of all, the delay on B550 versus X570 is huge, right? It's almost a year later. And then we look at the differences at a chipset level. They are sporting some differences, which B550, we've got 12 PCIe lanes versus 16 on X570. But on the X570, you've got those chipset lanes being all PCIe 4.0, whereas opposed to the B550, they're actually 4 PCIe 3.0 lanes and 8 PCIe 2.0 lanes. Though, of course, the CPU itself gives out 20 PCIe 4.0 lanes, 4 for an NVMe drive, and then 16 for that top slot for your graphics card and whatnot. So B550 essentially does have PCIe 4.0, it's just not on the chipset. So the benefit of this is it does allow the chipset heatsink to have no fan, and it runs a lot cooler. When we're testing this B550 right here with a graphics card and an M.2 loaded up over PCIe 3, it was giving out really good temperatures, so you've got nothing to worry about from here on in on B550s and chipset heatsink temperatures and worrying about having a fan on them. Just a simple heatsink on your B550 motherboard and you're good to go, pretty much just like the B450s out there. Now, in terms of the chipset pricing, this is one thing I kind of don't understand at the moment. I've been asking around everywhere to try and get an idea of how much you're paying for the actual license with B550 versus X570 versus B450, for example. And from what I can gather, I can only really guesstimate these costs, where I think B550 would be somewhere around $40 to $45, and B450, for example, would be somewhere around $20 to $25. And then X570 would be around $50 to $60. So you are getting a discount on the chipset license versus X570. But that being said, continuing through the differences, we no longer have as many USB 3.2 ports, where we've got up to a max of 8 3.2 ports on X570, and then a max of 2 3.2 and 4 3.1 in conjunction to 6 3.1 and 2 together. And then we've got a maximum of 6 USB 2 ports versus 4 on the X570. So they've given B550 the max allowance of 6. But this is the weird thing. With the B550 Taichi, you've actually got 11 in total USB 3 ports, where the front out, you'll get an additional 3.2, which makes it 3 in total. And then you've also got an additional 4 USB 3.1. So that makes it 11 USB 3 ports in total if you hook up your front I/O. So that's the main differences with B550 and X570, but you also get on select X570 boards support for SLI and also NVLink, whereas opposed to B550, you just get, in this case, crossfire support and no NVLink or SLI support. However, the good news all starts to come together for B550, where there are no limits on what the manufacturers can do with the VRM, and also with that, the overclock ability, where the B550 Taichi with the 3950X both out of the box, 3.95 gigahertz, you were just getting lukewarm on the heatsink and the VRM. So it was absolutely no stress at all. Even in the hottest climate in the world, you'd have no problems with this motherboard without even needing a fan. It's basically that good. Then we move on to the 4.3 gigahertz custom OC that I did here, which is pulling around 200 watts directly to the CPU as opposed to the 3.95 gigahertz. That's pulling about 126 watts. And I did cross-reference this with power from the wall just to make sure the figures are right in hardware info. And what we saw here was a maximum PCB readout temperature of 74 degrees, and then on the heatsink 65 degrees, and then the software readout was 69 degrees. So VRM with custom OCs, the max you can go on a 3950X pretty much, you are seeing this motherboard just handling it absolutely fine. This is in a 22C ambient 2, by the way, running Cinebench R20 while it's just constantly looped. So we're utilizing that AVX2 instruction set as well. Though going through this VRM more specifically, we've got here a 14 plus 2 phase power design, so 16 phases in total, 14 for the CPU, 2 for the SoC, and that is rigged up with Vishay SIC654CD 50 amp direct drive MOSFETs, and then they're using 60 amp inductors, and then for the doublers, We've got here the Intersil ISL6617As, and the PDIM controller is the RA229004. Then for the caps, they're 12K Nijicons. So this VRM is actually better than the X570 Taichi. So it is cool to see ASRock, and this is the first time I've seen this, where the little brother board is beating out the big brother in not just phases, but also the quality of some of the components, for instance, the 60 amp inductors. As for the heatsink, it's 253 grams, so slightly heavier than the X570 Taichi's heatsink, and it's made of all solid alloy, and it's got heat pads on both the inductors and the MOSFETs for cooling both those down. So for M.2 temperatures and slottage, they've got two NVMe slots on this board, the top one being PCIe 4.0, X4, and then the bottom being PCIe 3.0 X4, and they're both covered by heat sinks, and the heat sink does a pretty good job. So taking the temperatures down quite substantially with both the heat sink temperatures, the surface temperatures, and the software readouts. And then when we take the heat sink off, we can see there, we're getting kind of into that uncomfortable level where I wouldn't want to see my NVMe SSD running at those temperatures personally 24/7, especially if I'm editing videos. They're going through the onboard audio, they're using the Realtek 1220 ALC. It looks like they have kind of copy-pasted this from the X570 Taichi, though the numbers were slightly different. So going through the frequency response curve, first we've got a bass roll-off of 10 hertz and under, at around 2.3 decibels, which is absolutely fine. After that, we've got pretty much a flat line up until 10K and above, where we've got a 0.1 dB drop-off. So basically the frequency response curve is gonna be flat, it's gonna be good for your ears, and I even kind of prefer that slight drop-off in the treble. I'm not a big fan of treble personally, but then we move over to the crosstalk, and the numbers here are actually better than the X570 Taichi, coming with around minus 92 decibels, all the way up to a volume level of 90, then going from volume of 91 to 100, does have the crosstalk sort of bumping up on both left and right hand sides. So if you were to use this onboard audio, I recommend keeping the volume at 90 and under. Then move on to the mic import, they're using suppression. So basically this is gonna be good for chatting to your friends, playing games. They're gonna be hearing you clearly no matter what you do. At the same time, it's gonna give your voice a little bit of a thinner, tinny sound as opposed to a professional recording. So if you wanna use this for professional recordings, I would get another solution. Anyhow, moving through the BIOS, it's ASRock's typical It Can Do It BIOS. Very simple, yet has all the features you would want to a degree. And I will critique them here with the B550 Taichi, and that is they've taken away the polychrome RGB sync within the BIOS, which I really like and I really enjoy, and they've added it so you have to install it in Windows, which I'd like to see them add in an update to configure it from the BIOS. But they've also taken away the internet DHCP upgrade, so you just connect to the internet and then you can download the BIOS ROM. So there are two features I'd like to see them bring back. Though in terms of the other features, fantastic tuning, you can control all the different 7 PWM fan headers manually, and then you can overclock with ease for Ryzen 3950X. Getting this overclock at 1.4 volts for 4.3 gigahertz took me literally in half a minute, and the 4400 megahertz XMP profiles on this Aorus memory that I'm using worked absolutely fine first go around, no hiccups whatsoever. They do say you can go up to 4733 megahertz, and that definitely seems like it would be a possibility if you had memory that good. They're going through the input and output, we've got integrated IO shield, Wi-Fi 6, Bluetooth 5, BIOS flashback button, and a clear CMOS button, DisplayPort HDMI out, 8 USB ports, manual 5.1 surround out, optical out, and also an Intel 2.5 gigabits per second Ethernet, which does differ from the X570 Taichi's 1 gigabit per second Ethernet. So with all that out of the way, that now leads us to the most important part with a motherboard, and that is the price. So you would think B550 would be the value lineup like B450, but this time around, we're gonna have a massive range within B550. And this board right here is pretty much top of the line. It even goes topper than the X570 Taichi. So B550 itself is kind of like cut down X570, but it can be better, and it might be better for a lot of people, especially if you just wanna get a single NVMe drive, a 2 terabyte PCIe 4, for example, and a upcoming RTX 3000 graphics card or something like that. So it can give you better value within the realm of what it offers, but the price point is pretty high. I mean, we're looking at 280 USD for this board in Australia, 569 Aussie dollars, versus the X570 Taichi, which was $300 US, and then in Australia, 589 Aussie. Though in Australia, the X570, I did see it on sale for 529 Aussie. So at these price points, I would go with the X570 Taichi in Australia. Of course, when something's on sale and there's not that big of a difference between the two, I'd get the item on sale. Though as it stands, if they're both at MSRP and you want to get one of these two boards, I would personally go with the B550 Taichi. But the main reason for me would be, well, actually two things. That's the onboard audio slightly better, and then the VRM with that slightly enhanced 16 phase that does have slightly better components on it than the X570 Taichi. And that did show with these results. I mean, handling that 3950X with that OC, the way it did with the temperatures, no fans on the heatsink at all, with honestly really low temperatures, is something that ASRock have done well. Also, the last thing to go over that I forgot to mention was RGB. You've got four headers in total, two of those being addressable, and then two of those being 12 volt, and one each at the top and bottom. Though I would like to see ASRock in a BIOS update bring the polychrome RGB control back to the BIOS, as well as the internet update as well. Those two features, I actually really like them in the BIOS, so if they can get them in a BIOS update, I'll let you guys know. If they're coming in a BIOS update, I'll let you guys know in the description. And with all that out of the way, I hope you guys enjoyed today's review of the B550 Taichi. For me personally, it feels like this one in particular is an X550. That would be the way I would think of this board. And that aside, if you guys enjoyed this review, be sure to hit that like button. Also, let us know in the comment section below what you think of B550 so far. I actually had this motherboard for over a week. It's just there was an NDA on actually lifting the performance figures. So I do like to just give you guys reviews and numbers on motherboards rather than unboxings and showcases. So that's sort of the way I do things with motherboards, because when I go to buy a motherboard, I love it when there is all that information available and then I can make a decision. So hopefully that answers that. And speaking of answers, we've got here the question of the day, which comes from Transcendence Media, and they ask, which cooler would you suggest best for Ryzen 5 3600? My idle temp is 45 to 65 and gaming temp is 70 to 85. Well, the stock cooler is, well, should be a bit better than that. I mean, those temperatures do seem high. So for starters, you may want to look at what case you're using, especially if there's absolutely no airflow in that case, just take off the side panel to help it breathe a little bit easier. But in terms of a value for money cooler, since you are using the Ryzen 5 3600, I would go with my main hookup, and that is the Snowman. This thing is delivering amazing value for money. And if you get the two fan version, that thing was even handling a 10900K out of the box, which was pushing around 175 watts. So incredible cooler for the money. And we'll definitely see your Ryzen 5 3600 get some sweet overclocks too in the process and lower the temperatures. So hopefully that answers that question. And with all that aside, if you guys have stayed this far and you're enjoying that content, then be sure to stay subscribed or hit that sub button if you haven't already. Ring that bell to get the content as soon as it drops, because the next video, we've got a B550 comparison where we're testing out all these B550 motherboards that were sent in. It's gonna be a big round robin. So hopefully you guys enjoy that one, and I'll catch you in the next one. Peace out for now. Bye.